them to go out and be successful and to go to college and be productive citizens, that I really wanted to kind of hit three main themes in my classroom, and that was to prepare them to be scholars by achieving academic gains, to prepare them to be leaders, to give them, you know, the critical thinking skills to step up and to be able to make change in the world and make change in their own lives. And then I also wanted them to be citizens. I wanted them to be informed about our own country. I wanted them to be informed about the world around them. And I wanted them to be informed and interested in current events that were going on. So that became, you know, kind of my main overall, you know, big goal for the class. When I sit down to make a unit plan, I go back to my long-term plan that I created at the beginning of the year, which I know is all the learning goals that I identified in my long-term plan are the things that I want my students to achieve 80% on to kind of build themselves to be those scholars, leaders. I create a unit assessment to know, to have an aligned item for each, aligned item or a few, for each learning goal to assess it at that highest level. So if it's analyzing, I want to create analysis questions, or if it's simply an identifying or an explain, I have lower level questions that are aligned to that learning goal. So that unit assessment becomes my base for the rest of the unit that I use to kind of drive my daily. So then I go back to my learning goals after I've created my aligned items for each one, and I break down those learning goals into my daily objectives. Some learning goals are, you know, so I think at such a low level that they're automatically daily objectives. Others that are at the analysis level, I have to break down first into usually identify or define on a first day, or explain or describe on a second day, to kind of build them up to the level that they need to be at. So I look at that, I break them down into the daily objectives. And then when I go to lesson plan for a daily objective, I go back to that objective, I look to see what the learning goal is that it's aligned to, and then I also go back to that unit test to make sure that whatever lesson I create is going to build them towards being able to master those questions on the unit assessment. So when I look at my objective and I know what my, you know, kind of end result is going to be, the end, you know, idea or concept that I want them to articulate on the unit test, I use that to come up with my daily exit slip and what the kind of the level of mastery that I want them to be able to achieve on the daily level. When I have that exit slip identified, it's usually I try to keep it extremely modeled based on the way that I'm going to assess it on the unit test. So if it's going to be multiple choice on the unit test, I assess it as multiple choice on my exit slips. If it's a constructive response question on my unit test, I try to you know, assess it like that on the daily level. So I take that exit slip. From there, I kind of come up with my key points for the lesson. I know the points that I need to drive home for my students to be able to not only master the exit slip, but then eventually master the aligned item on the unit test. So the key points come from there, and then I, you know, create my, I actually go backwards. I create my independent practice, my guided practice, and then I go back to, you know, the new material to make sure I'm presenting the information in diverse ways throughout the unit. When I sat down to plan my lesson for this particular objective, I went back to my unit plan. I saw that my objective was that students would be able to define scarcity, supply, demand, product, raw materials, and then they would be able to identify those terms in a real-world example. I saw that that was aligned to my second economics learning goal of my North America unit, which was that students would be able to explain how supply and demand affect real-world prices. I then went to my unit assessment. I saw which questions were aligned to that second economics learning goal, and it was question 16, which was a scenario where students had to read a case study about pencils being made in the United States, and the United States not having enough of the supplies to make these pencils, and they had to answer the scarcity, who had the supply, what the supply was of, who had the demand, what the demand was for, and then also what the raw materials were in the scenario, and then finally what the final product was that was being made. So I used that aligned assessment, or that aligned item for my unit assessment, to model my exit slip after, since I knew that was the ultimate level that I wanted my students to be able to kind of articulate these concepts. I pulled, kind of made essentially a similar scenario for my exit slip, which happened to be about Burger King, the Whopper. So on that exit slip, they had to articulate the exact same questions, the scarcity, the supply, the demand, the raw materials, and the product, about the Whopper being made. So I used that, and then I took that as my exit slip. I knew that's what I wanted them to achieve on the daily level, and I kind of worked backwards from there. I knew that in independent practice, I wanted them to be able to do the same thing on their own with me kind of circulating around the room to help those specific students who were having problems, but the rest of the students got you know, some extra practice in that. So they answer the same questions, but about an iPod as the product in that situation. Going back to guided practice, the second example in guided practice was about De Beers, the Diamond Company, and they would work on, the idea was that they worked on that, that particular example with their partners. They have assigned partners in class, so they would work with those partners on their specific, on that specific question, talking through the answers. We went over them as a class, with, you know, kind of the ultimate question being that they had to justify their answers or explain their answers to the rest of the class so that I could get more insight into their actual thinking and their thought process and why they either got the questions right or the questions incorrect, and could kind of address those before they moved on to independent practice. The first guided practice example was about Nike Air Force Ones, and that was my think aloud example where I really went through the thought process with them of how I read a real life example and how I kind of talked aloud to them, and, you know, kind of the thoughts that were going through my head of what they needed to be able to do to identify the scarcity and to identify the supply and demand in the other terms. After I knew that that's how my independent practice and my guided practice were going to be formatted, I then went back to think, you know, my key points I know are those essential five definitions that I need to drive home. And so I went back and thought what was the best way and the simplest, most concrete way to present that to the students, which was to give them a basic example, and then we brainstormed as a class examples from their own lives to really tie back into that real world of things they had a scarcity of, things they had a supply of, or things they had a demand of.